If you have your Bible, turn with me in your Bible to the book of James chapter 1. We're going in our Bibles to the book of James, James chapter 1. And in the book of James chapter 1, we see the statement where James says that we need an unwavering faith. James chapter 1, the Bible says in verse number 5, it says this, "If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, that giveth to all men liberally, and upbraideth not, and it shall be given him. But," verse number 6, "but let him ask in faith, nothing wavering. For he that wavereth is like the wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed." The Bible says that we need an unwavering faith if we need wisdom in the last days. And we know that the source of wisdom is God Himself. The source of life, the source of wisdom, the source of joy is God Himself. And to be connected with the God of wisdom, to be connected in the last days with the God, with God of heaven, the God of heaven Himself, what we need is an unwavering faith. That him that wavereth, the Bible says, is like the wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. So what we need is an unwavering faith in order to connect us to God in these last days. The word unwavering means enduring. The word unwavering means firm. The word unwavering means unmovable, unshakable. We need an unmovable. We need an unshakable faith. We need a faith that is enduring. We need a faith that is abiding, abiding in Christ. And if we don't have this unwavering faith, we will not be able to stand when the last and final crisis comes upon the world and even comes to us, the test that shall test every soul. Do we have an unwavering faith? What are some of the characteristics of an unwavering or unmovable faith? An unwavering, an unmovable faith connects us to the source of life, which is God. And an unwavering, an unmovable faith is a faith that helps us to overcome sin. Are we overcoming sin? If we're overcoming sin, we are experiencing this unwavering, unmovable faith. The Bible says in 1 John chapter 5, 1 John chapter 5, that this unwavering and this unmovable faith is a faith that helps us, by the grace of God, to overcome sin. The Bible says in 1 John chapter 5 and verse number 4, 1 John 5, verse 4, it says, "For whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world. And this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith." So a faith that helps us to overcome the world, a faith that helps us to be born of God, is an unmovable, abiding faith in Christ. So if we have this unwavering faith, we are abiding in Christ, we are overcoming sin, we are overcoming temptations. And think about it, to have an unwavering faith, that means there must be things that try to wave us away from Christ. There must be trials, obstacles, temptations, difficulties that come to the child of God. And if we're abiding in Christ, we are unwavering, we're unmovable. Those trials, those temptations, those obstacles cannot push us away from Christ. We must have an unwavering faith to help us to overcome sin. This is the experience that we must have before the final crisis breaks loose. Let's go to Romans chapter 14. In Romans chapter 14, the Bible simply says, and I'm going to quote it, but the Bible simply says in Romans chapter 14, verse number 23, that faith, that whatsoever is not of faith is sin. So if we don't have this unwavering faith, we will be practicing sin. The Bible says, Romans chapter 14, verse 23, for he that doubteth is damned if he eat, because he eateth not of faith. But whatsoever is not of faith is sin. So this unwavering faith is strong in overcoming sin. This unwavering faith will not practice sin, but overcome sin. And no matter what obstacles or temptations or trials that are brought to the child of God, they are in Christ, they are unmovable, and they are strong and firm in the Lord. This is the kind of faith that is needed for the final generation, even as we are speak in the last days. This is the type of faith that is needed to endure the trials ahead of us, the temptations ahead of us, and even the great trial that will come upon all the world. This unwavering faith that connects us to God, that gives us power to overcome sin, this unwavering faith also is a faith that discerns and sees the devices of Satan and successfully overcomes them, successfully resists the temptations of Satan. Let's go to Ephesians chapter 6. Ephesians chapter 6. We see in Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 10, the Bible says, Ephesians 6 verse 10, it says, "Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might." Verse number 16 says, above all, and after it mentions all of the armor, it says above all, verse 16, taking the shield of faith, wherewith you shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. So no matter what fiery darts Satan is throwing at us, no matter what temptations Satan is throwing at us, no matter what obstacles we are going through, the child of God has a shield of faith to secure him and to be strong against the attacks of the enemy. We need such an unwavering faith that no matter what Satan throws at us in the last days, no matter what obstacles, no matter what temptations, no matter what sins, no matter what struggles, that we will not allow those things to take us away from God. The Bible says, "He that wavereth is like the wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed." If we have an unwavering faith, we're strong and firm in the Lord. But a wavering faith is driven with the wind and tossed here and tossed there. Do we have a wavering faith or an unwavering faith? On a wavering faith, you will have you are tossed here and there. You may be strong in the Lord one day, and then the next day you are weak and in sin. You may be strong in the Lord, serving God, praying, studying his word. The next day, you are sobbing and discouraged and crying. You want to shut yourself out from the world. One day, you are strong and singing the songs of Zion. You're making progress in your walk with God. The next day, you're knocked down to the ground and on your knees crying because of failures. What kind of faith do we have? Do we have an unwavering faith, or do we have the wavering faith, which is driven with the wind and is tossed through trials, through obstacles, through struggles, through temptations? What kind of faith do we have? If we have a wavering faith, it is God's desire that all of us overcome, that all of us resist the temptations of Satan, that all of us overcome discouragement, that all of us overcome disappointments, that all of us overcome the trials that we go through, and that we leave from the wavering faith to the unwavering faith experience, which overcomes sin, which successfully resists the temptations of Satan, and which keeps us firm in Christ, abiding in Christ, overcoming sin, so that we can be prepared for the final crisis that is ahead. Notice what the Bible says in Romans chapter 12. Romans chapter 12. God has given to every child of God a faith. And no matter how small that faith is, God wants that faith to grow. The Bible says, Romans chapter 12 and verse number 3, it says this, "For I say, through the grace given unto me to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God had dealt to every man the measure of faith." So the Bible says God has given to every man, to every woman, to every boy, to every girl, a measure of faith. God has given to every one of us faith. And if that faith is small, and if that faith is weak, God desires for us to grow in that faith so that we can develop a stronger, abiding, and enduring relationship with Christ, and develop from the wavering faith to the unwavering faith that shall not be moved in the last days. So all of us have a measure of faith. And God wants that measure of faith to grow stronger. God wants that measure of faith to get larger. God wants us to have an abiding trust and to overcome sin. Now, the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 1, now faith, what is faith? Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. So faith is something that you cannot see with your own physical eyes, but faith is the substance of things hoped for, it's tangible, it's substance, of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. We all hope for salvation. We all hope to be saved. We all hope to overcome sin. We all hope all these things. We hope to overcome trials and obstacles and disappointments. We hope to see the end result of how God can set us free from even the trials of everyday life. But as we put our trust in God, as we put our faith in God, not seeing it, it is the evidence of things not seen. We have faith believing that God is able to give us victory over every circumstance. This is the faith that God wants us to grow in, that no matter what we cannot see, we put our faith in the Word of God, believing that God's Word does not change, that God's will for our life does not change, and that God will help us to overcome every trial, every obstacle that we face. Romans chapter 10. Romans chapter 10, the Bible says in verse 17, what do I do if my faith is weak? The Bible says in Romans 10, verse 17, it says, so then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So if my faith is weak and my faith is wavering, that shows that I need to spend more time in the Word of God. If I'm not overcoming sin, when sin and temptation comes to my door, and I am wavering, I'm back and forth in my relationship with God, I need to spend time in the Word of God to grow my faith. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. So in order to overcome sin and to successfully resist the temptations of Satan, to overcome trials and obstacles and disappointments, I need to spend more time in the Word of God. The Word of God is full of promises. Promises to us, the child of God. And when we spend time in the Word of God, we're strengthening our faith to have an unwavering faith in the last days. The Bible says we need to spend more time studying the Word of God. Faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. So we need to study the Word of God. If we want an unmovable faith, which will stand in the time of crisis, we need to spend more time in the Word of God. Memorizing Scripture, putting the Word of God in our minds, meditating on the Word of God, and letting the Word of God bring faith and power into the life is what will give us a stronger, unwavering faith. Also, the Bible says in Luke chapter 17, let's go there. Luke chapter 17, we need an unwavering faith in these last days. So that we can be prepared for the final crisis that is coming upon the earth. Luke chapter 17 says that if we are lacking in faith, if our faith is not growing, we should pray and ask God to grow and to increase our faith. Luke chapter 17, the Bible says in Luke 17, verse 5, and the apostle said unto the Lord, increase our faith. So we need to ask the Lord to increase our faith. If our faith is weak, if we're falling into sin, our relationship with God, we're tossed about. The Bible says he that wavereth is like the wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. We're here and there. If we have this weak faith, we need to spend more time in prayer asking God to increase our faith. So we need to spend more time studying his word, and we need to spend more time praying and pleading and asking God to increase our faith. And this experience will help us to overcome sin. This experience will help us to successfully to resist the fiery darts of the wicked, because we have the shield of faith. This is the unwavering experience that every child of God must have and bring into their souls. Faith is not just belief in God. Faith grabs hold of Christ and brings him into the soul. And when Christ comes into the soul, resisting temptation becomes easy. When Christ comes into the soul, overcoming sin becomes easy, because it's not our work, it is Christ's work. And as we submit ourselves to Christ, Christ will fight our battles for us. Go with me to 1 Timothy chapter 6. 1 Timothy chapter 6. The Bible says in 1 Timothy chapter 6, when temptations come our way, when trials come our way, when obstacles come our way, we can overcome as we lay hold on Christ. 1 Timothy chapter 6, the Bible says in verse number 12, it says, fight the good fight of faith and lay hold on eternal life, whereunto thou art also called, and hast professed a good profession before many witnesses. So the Bible says, fight the good fight of faith. How do I fight this good fight of faith? It says, lay hold of eternal life. So as I lay hold upon Christ, I can have victory in this fight of faith. We must lay hold upon Christ. It's not enough to go to church. It's not enough to just hear messages online. It's not enough to just go to a public meeting. We must bring Christ into the soul. Personally, we must grab hold of Christ and bring him into our experience. This is the unwavering faith experience. The Bible says we must lay hold upon Christ as a personal savior from sin. We must lay hold upon Christ and bring him into the soul. It says lay hold. We lay hold of something with our hands. And the Bible says faith is the substance of things hoped for, the substance. With your hands, you bring Christ personally into your soul. So those in the last days who will have an unwavering faith, they will overcome sin. They will overcome the temptations of the enemy, the devices of Satan which war against their souls. They will have Christ inside of them. They will lay hold of him and bring him into their souls. Go with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, we need to bring Christ into the soul. It's not enough to go to church. It's not enough to hear the word of God. We must bring him personally into the soul. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 3, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 3, it says, but if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them who are lost, that are lost, and whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. For we preach not ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who commandeth the light to shine out of darkness, hath shined where? It shined in our hearts. Where does Christ want to be? Christ wants to be in our hearts. It shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. We're going to come back to that. Verse number 7 says, but we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of his power may be of God and not of us. Christ wants to come into the heart, into the soul. And the unwavering faith brings Christ into the soul. The unwavering faith fights the good fight of faith, lays hold of eternal life, and brings eternal life into the soul when Christ comes into the soul. Because the Bible says in Romans 6 and verse 23, it says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. So the lay hold of eternal life is to lay hold of Jesus Christ and bring Christ into the soul, bring Christ into the heart. And we must have the light of the glorious gospel of Christ shine into the heart. Notice what verse 6 says again. It says, for God who commanded the light to shine out of darkness had shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. So the light of the glory of God, the light of Christ wants to shine into our hearts. So faith grabs hold of Christ and brings Christ into the heart. Faith brings the light of the gospel of Christ into the heart. And this light represents the life of Christ. Go with me to John chapter 1. We're going to come back to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. We're going to the book of John chapter 1. So this faith lays hold on Christ and brings Christ into the heart. John chapter 1, the Bible says in verse number 4. John chapter 1 and verse 4, the Bible says this. In him, that's in Christ. In Christ, in him was life. And the life was the light of men. So when I bring Christ, his life, into my heart, into my mind, into my soul, the Bible says, I have his life. His life is the light of men, and the light of the glorious gospel wants to shine in my heart. So when I bring Christ, his life, into my heart, I have his light, his life. Is that clear? So we must have a faith that brings Christ into the heart, which shows that we must have the life of Christ. Did Christ have an unwavering faith? Did Christ overcome every sin. That Christ overcome every device, every fiery dart of the wicked, every temptation of Satan. Did Christ overcome every obstacle? Did Christ overcome every situation? Did Christ overcome difficulties, discouragement, depression? Did Christ overcome disappointments? Did Christ overcome these things? And if I am going to have the unwavering faith, I must bring Christ into my heart so that I can overcome as Christ also overcame. Go with me to John 16. Going to the book of John 16, the Bible says in John 16, going in our Bibles to the book of John 16, that we must have the very life of Christ and overcome as Christ has overcome. And we can overcome as Christ also overcame. The Bible says in John chapter 16, verse number 33, John 16, verse 33 says, "These things have I spoken unto you, that ye might have peace. In the world you will have tribulations. In the world you will have trials. In the world you will have temptations. In the world you will have obstacles. In the world you will have all these things. In the world," the Bible says, "but be of good cheer, for I," Christ, "for I have overcome the world." And if we bring Christ into the heart, would not we overcome trials? Would not we overcome obstacles? Would not we overcome temptations? Would not we overcome as Christ overcame? This is the unwavering faith experience. Every child of God must bring Christ into the soul and overcome as Christ overcame, as we get ready to prepare for the final crisis. Was there a crisis in Christ's day? Did not Christ have to face the cross? Is there not a cross ahead of us as we seek to prepare for Christ's coming? So we need the unwavering faith, which prepares us for the final crisis. The unwavering faith, as Christ overcame, we also are to overcome. And this light, we said, was the life of Christ. The life was the light of men. Go with me to Isaiah chapter 61. Isaiah, turning in the Bibles to the book of Isaiah, and notice what the Bible says in the book of Isaiah, Isaiah chapter 60. The Bible says in Isaiah chapter 60 that we must have the life, the light of Christ in the soul. The Bible says, "Arise," Isaiah 60 verse 1, "arise, shine, for thy light is come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon thee." It says, "For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and gross darkness the people. But the Lord shall rise upon thee, and his glory shall be seen upon thee." Verse number 3, "And the Gentiles shall come to thy light, and the kings to thy brightness," the Bible says, "of thy rising." We must have Christ in the soul. It says, "Arise, shine, for thy light," Christ, "has come into the soul." Christ must come into the soul. Christ must come into the life. Christ, his victories, his power, his faith, his experience must come into the soul. And even though the world is in darkness, it says, "For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and gross darkness the people," as the world is confused, as the world is meddling in sin, as the world is struggling with habits and addictions. God's people should have the light of Christ coming into the soul and receiving and obtaining victory in Christ, his life, his power, his victories, an unwavering experience, and not wavering and going back and forth in a relationship with God, an unwavering, abiding experience, and preparing the whole world to see the light of Christ so that they can come to Jesus. The Bible says in verse 3, "The Gentiles shall come to thy light." So the world who sees Christ in us, they would come. If we would just shine for Christ, the Bible says in Matthew chapter 5, if we would just let the light of Christ and the life of Christ come into the soul, it would attract many to Christ. But the reason why they're not coming to Christ is because the life of Christ is not inside of us. We need this unwavering faith. We need to spend more time in prayer. We need to spend more time in the study of God's word. We need to ask the Lord to come into the soul so that we can do a work of winning souls to Christ before it's too late. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 5 and verse number 16 says, "Let your light So shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. So if we want the life of Christ, we must open our hearts to Christ and let his light shine into our souls. The light of the knowledge of the glory of God shine into our souls. By faith, bring him into the soul. By prayer, by faith, bring him into the soul. By studying his word, we said prayer, increase our faith should be our prayer. And studying his word, the Bible says faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of God, and laying hold of eternal life, Christ can come into the soul, and the powers of darkness and sin would vanish away, and only the life and the light of Christ can come, and the Gentiles would come to our light. Oh, friends, this is the unwavering faith experience that we must have in the last days. Now is not the time to waver and mingle in sin. Now is the time to beg God and plead for the outpouring of God's Holy Spirit so that we can overcome every trial, every obstacle, every difficulty, every temptation, every sin. We can overcome as Christ overcame. The Bible says, now how can we make this practical? How can I overcome as Christ overcame? Go with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Going back to 2 Corinthians, I said we'll go back. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, and the Bible says that this light, that this life, this experience, this unwavering faith experience is shown in the face of Christ. The Bible says, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, and verse number 6, for God, who commendeth the light to shine out of darkness, hath shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. So if I want the life of Christ, if I want Christ to come into my heart, to give me his life, I must see it where? In the face of Jesus Christ. And as I look at the face of Jesus Christ, notice what happens. The next verse says, but we have this treasure in earthen vessels. So if we would look at the face of Christ, Christ would come into this earthen vessel. The Bible says, we have this treasure in earthen vessels that the excellency of his power may be of God and not of us. So the power of God, the experience of the gospel would come into my soul if I look in the face of Jesus Christ. Okay, let's connect all these points now. Let's connect the life of Christ, the light of Christ coming into the soul, to the faith experience and the unwavering faith to prepare us for the final crisis. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 12, Hebrews chapter 12, what happens when I look at the face of Jesus Christ? What will happen to my faith when I look in the face of Jesus Christ? The Bible says, Hebrews chapter 12, verse number 1 and verse number 2 says, wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, it says, let us lay aside every weight, and the sin which doth easily beset us. See, we don't want to waver. So we must lay aside every weight and the sin which doth easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us. Verse number 2 says, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our what? Of our faith, who, for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, the Bible says, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. So as we look to Jesus, the Bible says what will happen to our faith. He's the author and the finisher of our faith. Our faith would grow if we would look to Jesus Christ. You remember in Matthew chapter 14? As a matter of fact, let's hold our finger in Hebrews 12. We're going to come back there. Hebrews 12, we'll hold our finger there. Let's go to Matthew chapter 14. You remember in Matthew 14, when Peter was walking on the water with Jesus, what happened? As Peter kept his eyes on Jesus, his faith was strong. We're in Matthew 14. As Peter kept his mind on Christ, his faith was strong. As Peter kept his mind on the promise of Christ, that Christ was with him, and Jesus said, come with me on the water, believing the word of God that he can come on the water, when he had a sinking nature, when he kept his mind on the word of God and the promise, he was able to have an unwavering faith. Okay? And then, as Peter was walking on the water, he took his mind off of Jesus. He took his mind off the promise of the Word of God. And what happened? He looked at the wind and started to sink beneath the trial. He looked at the wind and started to sink beneath the temptation. He looked at the trial and he began to sink under the obstacles, under the disappointment, under the trial. Is there a lesson for us in the last days? Yes, the lesson is we must keep our eyes on Jesus so that we can have faith. And if we look at those obstacles, we will have a wavering faith if we look at the obstacles. But if we look at Jesus, we'll have an unwavering faith. Look at this. Matthew chapter 14. The Bible says, Matthew 14, it says in verse 28, and Peter answered him. This is when Jesus was coming on the water. Peter answered him, Lord, if it be thou, bid me come unto thee on the water. And he said, come. This is Jesus speaking. And Peter was come down out of the ship, and he walked on the water to go to Jesus. Verse number 30 says, but when he saw that the wind was boisterous, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, he cried, saying, Lord, save me. Verse number 31 now says, and immediately Jesus stretched forth his hand and caught him and said unto him, O thou of little faith, wherefore didst thou doubt? And when they were come into the ship, the wind ceased. So as he took his mind off of Jesus, the Bible says he had what? Little faith. And we must have an unwavering faith, which shows us that we cannot take our mind off Christ. That no matter what trial we go through, what obstacle we go through, what difficulty we go through, if we take our mind off of Christ and set it upon the trial, we will sink beneath the trial. How many of us have been discouraged this week? How many of us have cried and murmured and complained this week? How many of us have shut ourselves out from the world because we have been going through some difficult times and we took our minds off Christ, and as a result, we sink beneath the trial. Those in the last days must learn to train their minds on Christ to overcome disappointment, to overcome all these discouraging situations, and keep their minds on the Lord despite the trials that we go through. So we can overcome if we keep our mind on Christ. And here's the lesson. Even though Peter was with Jesus, Jesus did not remove the obstacle. Jesus did not remove the trial. Jesus did not remove the temptation. Is that clear? So we will have to go through trials. We will have to go through temptations. We will have to go through obstacles, but we must have such a faith in God, an unwavering faith. An unwavering faith, an enduring faith, an abiding trust in God, that no matter what we go through, we can trust Him and we can walk upon His promise. This is the faith that God wants us to have in the last days. We will go through trials even though we have faith. Look at the story of Joseph. Joseph was betrayed by his brothers. Joseph was in a prison. Joseph was in a pit. He had to go through a crisis, but was not God with Joseph in the crisis? Look at the three Hebrew boys. They were thrown in the fiery furnace, but was not God with them as they went through their trial? What about Daniel? Did not Daniel go in the lion's den? But was not God with Daniel as he went through his trial? The children of Israel, as they left Egypt, did not they go through trials? They had to go through hunger, and they had to go through a period of thirsty. They were thirsty. They had to go through a period of not drinking any water, but yet was not God with them as they went through their trial. What about Jesus? Did not Jesus come, the Son of God himself, and did not he hunger for 40 days and 40 nights? Did not he go through the cross of Calvary? Did not he go through the scenes of Gethsemane? Was not he, Christ himself, whipped, and was not Christ himself going through the trials of the cross? And if Christ had to go through the trials of the cross, the Bible says that the servant is not greater than his Lord. We need such an unwavering faith that no matter what we go through, that we trust in God. We need such an unwavering faith that no matter what we go through, no matter what circumstances we face, if the bills cannot be paid, Okay, let's get personal. If the bills cannot be paid, if we cannot find the funds to go to school, if we cannot find a job to take care of responsibilities, that if we go through these things, we should have such a faith in God, an unwavering faith to believe that God has brought us this trial, He'll be with us through the trial, and that we can overcome this trial if we have faith in God. And what every child of God must have in the last days is an unwavering faith, as Christ had His unwavering faith. Friends, is there a trial that will come to the people of God in the last days? Is there a great trial that will come to the saints of God in the last days? Go with me in your Bible to the book of Revelation 13. Revelation chapter 13. There is a great trial that is going to come upon the whole world, and God has to test us now. For the small tests and trials that we go through, we're training our minds and preparing our minds to keep it on the Lord Jesus Christ, are preparing us for the great and final trial that will come upon the whole world, the great and final trial, the great and final crisis that God's people will meet in the last days. The Bible says in Revelation chapter 13, the Bible says in Revelation 13, verse number 10, let's look at verse 10. It says, "He that leadeth into captivity shall go into captivity. He that killeth with the sword must be killed with the sword. Here is the patience and the what? And the faith of the saints." Will the saints face persecution? Yes. Will the saints face hunger? Oh, notice what the Bible says. The Bible says in verse 16. Verse 16, the Bible says, it says, "And he causeth all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their forehead, in their right hand or in their foreheads, that no man might be able to buy or sell, save he that hath the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name." So when the mark of the beast is in force, when the mark of the beast is in force, when we will not be able to buy or sell. We would have to have a faith to endure. An unwavering faith, a faith to endure, and a faith to abide in Christ, a faith that will trust in His promises, a faith to endure hunger, you won't be able to buy or sell, a faith to endure weariness, a faith to endure trials. We need this faith. And the Bible says that the saints also would be killed. Is that clear? So we would have to have a faith in God that even if my life is at stake, that I will trust in God. That's why Job says, he says, "Though he slay me, yet will I trust him." Our faith must be so strong in God that no matter what obstacles we go through, God is able to give us victory. God is able to sustain us through the trial because we do not go through these obstacles alone. The Bible says in Isaiah 43, let's go there. Isaiah 43, my friends, I'm excited about this message. Isaiah 43, we need an unwavering faith, and only God can help us as we keep our minds on Him to give us grace for every trial, to give us power for every obstacle, to give us power for every circumstance, even every temptation now we currently face. The Bible says in Isaiah 43, "But now, thus saith the Lord, that created thee, O Jacob, that he formed thee, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed thee." It says, "I have called thee by thy name, and thou art mine." And when, it didn't say if, it didn't say if. See, we will go through trials, my friends. We will go through hardship, difficulties, and temptations. It says, "When thou passest through the water, I will be with you." It says, "Through the rivers, they shall not overflow thee. And when thou walkest through the fire, thou shalt not be burned, neither shall the flame kindle upon thee. For I am the Lord thy God, the Holy One of Israel, thy Savior. I gave Egypt for thy ransom, and Ethiopia and Sheba for thee." The Bible says, when you go through these things, yes, we will go through these things. Yes, we will suffer temptations. Yes, we will suffer obstacles. Yes, we'll go through disappointments. But we must train our minds to believe that no matter what temptation we go through, that God loves us and that God will never put more on us than we can bear. God is able to secure those who are tempted. God is able to give us power over every obstacle, over every circumstance. And not only that, but God will be with us as we go through these things. He says, I will be with you. So no matter what trial we go through now, we must believe that Christ is with us. And if Christ is with us, if he has given us the trial, he will not allow that trial to overcome us. We will have faith by his grace to overcome every trial. Friends, this is the unwavering faith that every child of God must have as we get closer to the end of time. Why does God permit me to go through trials? Why does God need me to go through trials? We're going to close with this last verse. 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1. Why does God allow me to go through hardship, to go through trials, to go through difficulties? Why? Because the trials is where we learn to have unwavering faith. Because those trials will try to wave us back and forth, to take our minds off of God, that we sink beneath depression, that we sink beneath the obstacle, that we sink beneath the temptation. Those trials will do us best to wave us away from God. And in order to have unwavering faith, there must be a wind trying to wave us. There must be a storm, a sea trying to wave us. And if we learn to put our minds on the Lord, to be firm, to be steadfast, to be enduring, as we go through life's trials, life's temptations, life's obstacles, God can help us to have an unwavering faith. If there was nothing to wave us, how can you have an unwavering faith? So God wants you to have an unwavering faith to be able to stand in the last days, to be prepared for the final crisis. The Bible says, 1 Peter chapter 1, verse number 5, it says this, who are kept by the power of God through faith. We're kept by the power of God through faith, unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time, wherein ye greatly rejoice, though now for a season, if need be, ye are in heaviness through manifold temptations, many temptations, many trials. We are in heaviness, but it says, verse number 7, that the trial of your faith, being much more precious than gold that perisheth, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ. So these trials are to try us, the Bible says, to prepare us for the appearing of the Lord Jesus Christ. It goes on to say, verse number 8, whom having not seen, ye love, and whom, though now ye see him not, yet believing, ye rejoice with unspeakable joy, unspeakable and fullness and full glory. Rejoice with joy, unspeakable and full glory. Verse 9 says, receiving the end of your faith, the end of our faith, even the salvation of your souls. So God has given to every man a measure of faith to grow. But the end of our faith, the result of our faith, the completion of our faith is an unwavering, unmovable faith. So God sends the trial to give us that unmovable, that unwavering, that stable faith to prepare us for his second coming. Do we have an abiding relationship with God? Are we wavering in our Christian walk with the Lord? How much time do you spend in the study of God's word? How much time do you spend in prayer? How much time do you spend meditating on the word of God? And while the trial comes, that obstacle comes, that difficulty comes, that problem comes, are you giving it to the Lord or are you wavering back and forth? It's time for us to learn to trust fully in the Lord. The Bible says, trust in the Lord with all thine heart. Lean not unto thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct our paths. We must agonize with God in prayer. We must learn to trust God, even if our eyes say that the word of God is not true, because our circumstances seem to contradict the very thing which we believe. We must believe the word of God, that God is not a man that he should lie. Oh, for grace to trust him more. We need this experience, this unwavering faith, to stand in the last great crisis. Father in heaven, our hearts have been touched by thy spirit. Lord, we thank you that you have given us these trials, these obstacles, these situations that we cannot handle in and of ourselves. But the solution is to look to Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Help us to look to you, that we may become stronger, that we may grow. Help us to focus on you and not to magnify the difficulty or the problem or the trial, but to look to you, because you are able to give us power over every sin, over every temptation, over every trial. Please, dear God, we put our trust in you. We love you and we thank you. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.